I was asked whether I think that Angela Merkel is naive or if there's a hidden agenda or something like that. She was definitely a communist youth leader, and I will tell you, yes, she's still a communist, maybe a closet communist, but still a communist, and she has an agenda, so she's not naive. She knows exactly what's going on. Sorry, that was the first question. Yeah. Speak out because they're afraid. They don't want to lose their job. Okay? Yeah, I mean, people, no organization whatsoever. People know what's going on. Lots of people, not all of them, but lots of people know what's going on. But they know exactly what the repercussions are, so they won't say anything. Yeah, and silence means consent. I don't know, survival. Look, I mean, you've paid a price. I've paid a price. You know, I don't know.
Can you do this speech back home?
No, I cannot do this speech back home under no circumstances. I would not find an audience, and I would not find a place where I can actually speak.
We'll
no. Wait. One at a time.
Okay.
Yes, ma'am. Well, first of all, I'm not into conspiracy theories. I'm sure there are, you will know a lot of conspiracy theories. I don't go by conspiracy theories, I go by facts. And yes, there may be, you know, New World Order and you know, other stuff, but that's not something that I work with. I look at what's happening, I look at what's going on the ground, and that's what I work with. So again, having said that, I can't really speculate as to what is going on between Obama and Merkel. I really don't know. It would be pure speculation, knowing that Obama is probably the best community organizer around. We can assume he's not sitting in his mansion reading books to and with Valerie Jarrett. I think we can safely assume that. And maybe if they're reading books together, then it's probably going to be Alinsky, right? Yeah. So I don't want to speculate. It's, well, he's out of office. She's still in office. So, and she will, I think she'll remain in office. I don't know what you think, Karen, but I'm afraid she will remain in office. Yes. We desperately need a constitution like yours, but historically I don't think it's ever going to happen, and we're too far along down that slippery slope of the European Union. I mean, they started this project, and can you mute this for go to Turkey? Who mentioned Turkey? Yeah, sorry, I didn't go into that, so I'll go into that now. What's going on in Europe right now with all of a sudden a strong Holland, strong Netherlands, a strong Denmark, a not so strong Germany, and a strong Austria is a very interesting situation. I can't really tell you yet what to make of it because I'm not there. Okay, so I'm you know, I just read Austrian newspapers in the morning, so I don't really have any of the feedback. But I think that's my personal opinion. What's going on in the Netherlands is, you have to remember March 15th, the coming Wednesday, elections, general elections. Who's leading the polls? Bingo. Why is the incumbent prime minister, Rutte, showing strength. Just put two and two together and don't say five. Okay? I think he's trying to undermine Geert Wilders. That's my opinion. Okay? People are easy to influence, right?
Absolutely.
If you don't have strong values, it's easy to stray, right? My opinion. Please don't, you know, I'm here. I'm now into American politics because I watch Fox News all the time. So I'm not as knowledgeable yet, but I look to Europe and I'm like, oh my God, what is going on there? And I'll tell you what, when Erdogan starts sending those refugees, asylum seekers again, you know, that deal between the European Union and Erdogan, I think he's already said he would actually start sending them again. So he's blackmailing Europe. I think that's gonna cause a lot of problems for a lot of governments in Europe. Last point, Erdogan. I snuck into a high-level meeting, conference, called the Alliance of Civilizations. You may have heard of that. Together with Marsha Henrik. Okay? In, what was it, 14, 15? And we snuck in there disguised as journalists. And I saw Erdogan for the first time in person, just, you know, across the room. And I can tell you, I had shivers when he spoke. I looked at his facial expression. I had shivers, and I said, this man is the new Hitler. And again, I've been proven correct. That's what he's planning, right? We all know what he's planning. He's saying it. He's telling us. Well, he wants to reinstate the death penalty in Turkey. That's one of the reasons why there's so much uproar in Austria and in Europe right now, because there is a referendum planned in Turkey, and all the government ministers. Erdogan's ministers are now fanning out and going to different European countries to talk to the large Turkish populations there. And he wants a Turkish empire. Mm-hmm. That's his goal. Mm-hmm. And I don't want that. So it scares me. And I'm very afraid. I'm not very, you can't scare me very easily. But Erdogan really, really scared me when I saw him. Noni, wait. First you, and then Noni, please. Thank you.
In Europe, is it possible?
Not yet.
They can get that.
Yeah. And even if it were censored, you know, there's Whitopia, right? You know, there's always the possibility of getting around that. I mean, nowadays, you know, we had, in the beginnings of the internet, when I was still living in Kuwait, we had censorship. I couldn't access any of the, or very few of the European websites at the time. Now it would be no problem because I'd get Whitopia and circumvent that. Get a different, what is it called? IP address, thank you. Okay.
Along those lines, is there a Fox News for Europe?
No.
Not Fox brand, but is
there? I know what you mean, no.
Not at all?
No.
Nowhere?
No. Not that I know of.
Not Sky News?
No.
What was the question?
Is there a Fox News in Europe? A Fox News type?
Is there a conservative media in Europe?
No. No conservative media at all. But what's interesting is that the Austrian Freedom Party has its own news channel, and it's they upload it to YouTube, I think, every week, and it's a tremendous success. And when Geert Wilders was in Austria, I think in 15, he was so impressed. He said he would also, you know, start something like that. I don't know if he got around to it. I think he did, but I'm not really sure. But that's the closest you can get.
Not even radio?
We don't have talk radio in Europe. No, no, it's unheard of. Noni. Yes.
Which means that Europe is allowing this to happen.
Yes.
Which
I agree.
Yes.
Yes.
biblical values, and secularism, because secularism on its own, without a foundation, calling itself a religion that feeds it. Islam feeds secularism, because I think secularism wants Islam. It's very attracted to Islam. Mm-hmm. And the war between Islam and the Bible is starting right now in the West, in Europe and America.
I would call it a war between Judeo-Christian values
and Islamic
values. And Islamic
and secularism
values.
With secularism and Islam are one.
I mean, you can be secular in a Judeo-Christian civilization, okay? But,
yeah,
I mean, what you're talking about is rabid secularism, I understand.
Yeah, secularism usually ends up being anti-biblical.
Yes, or anti-creator.
And this anti-biblical movement
mm-hmm.
is very strong in Europe.
Yeah.
And loves Islam.
Yeah.
And that's where the... the collision happens.
Without, you know, going into biblical values or anything of the sort, I always say, if the world followed the Ten Commandments, the world would be a better place.
That's
right?
A biblical value.
I'm saying that, but it's easier to call it, you know, if we all of us, no matter what we are, followed the Ten Commandments, you know, the world would be a better place. And Islam doesn't have Ten Commandments.
The secularists in America want to take out the Ten Commandments.
Exactly.
Because
and
they are biblical.
Look at the European Union. When the Constitution, the European Constitution was adopted, or before it was adopted, there was massive discussion about what to do, should we have in the Constitution any reference to God? Well, I guess, what? There's nothing in the Constitution, no reference to God. So that means we're a godless society,
and that's why we attract Islam.
Exactly. And if we don't have any values at all, of course it's easy to succumb to Islamic values. My opinion, personal opinion.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
And then you.
Thousands of judges, of teachers, of you know, whoever. I mean, these people are all in jail. I don't know any reports of killed, but you know, being jailed probably corresponds to being killed.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
Who did this?
Now in Western Europe.
Which country?
Turkey.
What's happening in Western Europe? So journalism is effectively dead, or they're just mouthpieces of the state. What's happening here?
Well, I mean, the journalists. I would compare it. You know, if I said this in Europe, I'd probably be hanged. But I would say, I would use the German word Gleichschaltung.
Which is?
What do we call Gleichschaltung? I mean, it's a word that's also used in English when you study the rise of National Socialism. You know, when everything becomes equal.
Who?
I didn't go into Turkey. No.
Okay.
This conference was in Vienna. And it was under the auspices of the Austrian Foreign Ministry. It was an annual conference for the Alliance of Civilization, which is a UN-sponsored lovey-dovey conference where you know, all civilizations, all religions are equal, and they're equally good, and we all love each other. And it was actually a scary brainwashing of young people, because there were a lot of young people. You know, students. What is it? Did you check Gleichschaltung?
Yeah, it's in Nazi terminology. Gleichschaltung was the process of Nazification by which Nazi Germany successively established a system of totalitarian control which made everything the same and coordination over all aspects of society. The less formal definition is the standardization of political, economic, and social institutions as carried out in authoritarian states.
You will
so
find
equivalent saying that they can only happen under authoritarian states.
Exactly. And it's a word that you will actually find in school books or used to. I mean, Gleichschaltung.
Saying the same thing.
Yeah. So, and again, I would not say these words in Austria or in Europe at all. Okay, I'm really now exercising my First Amendment rights. I would not get away with saying that.
So is the mentality the same as political practice?
Yeah, in Austria, I self-censor myself all the time. I really haven't, I've been through this once. I don't have the desire to go through it again. It was very expensive and time-wise and money-wise.
But what happens if you say something here and it's heard online there?
First Amendment, I'm here. So if you put this online, whoever listens to this, I am physically in the United States of America right now, and I am exercising my First Amendment rights as a visitor to this beautiful country. Yes. I promised you, and then Deborah.
What do you see as Merkel's endgame?
Good question. I don't know. She hasn't written a book, so we probably don't know.
Has there been any discussion in Europe as to what there might be behind her?
No. No. Mm-mm. Noni, tell me if I'm wrong, but if you're a Muslim, you always leave some semblance of your Muslim being inside you. You know, I've been told by Sam Solomon, he still acts sometimes as a, you know, Sam Solomon, right? As a Muslim. So it's never 100% out of your system. And she was a communist, so I guess there's still some have more communist thinking, others have less communist thinking. But I think that might be one of the reasons. She still has that totalitarianism inside her. She was raised as a communist, so it's there. It's there, okay? Just as when I smell Middle Eastern food, it will always, you know, bring back memories of my youth. So that's how it is. That's how, I guess, that's how the mind works. But again, my own opinion. Okay.
What about your youth?
Growing up in Iran, Iraq, working in Kuwait and Libya as an adult.
Thank you.
Working at the Austrian embassy, and my dad was a diplomat.
Yeah, you have an American accent.
I grew up in the U.S. I went to school, and in eighth grade, I had to study the Constitution in order to pass eighth grade and go on to high school. And I always tell the story at the time, you know, I was 13 years old, you know, in the middle of puberty, and I said, why do I have to study the U.S. Constitution? It's not mine. I should be studying my own constitution. Again, you know, I didn't have a choice. I had to study it. And little did I know back then that my very, very liberal Chicago social studies teacher would have such an effect on me later on, because I don't know if there are many Austrians or many Europeans who have such an intimate and intensive knowledge of American history and the American Constitution. So, you know, thanks to my upbringing in the U.S., I can talk to you about the United States Constitution and get away with it, actually. I promised you, and then we'll go here.
With regard to the comments about First Amendment rights and speculation about who that is in Europe, I have to say, I don't think it would make a difference without Second Amendment rights.
Well, I was actually referring to the entire Bill of Rights.
Right.
You can't have a Second Amendment without the First, obviously.
Right. Because the, as we know, the political class does what they will and they're currently doing. So I'm not surprised by what the political elite are doing across Europe.
Well, I'm not surprised either.
No, I'm not surprised in that if you look at the progressives who are all some derivation of Marxism, whatever, you know,
mm-hmm.
whatever derivation they are, left or right, because a lot of the conservative quote unquote parties are actually progressive, and then we've got some of that going on here too. But that doesn't surprise me, because it's very understandable that if you believe in annihilation and nihilism in order to, you know,
mm-hmm.
if you believe in a Hegelian dialectic for God,
yeah, I know.
Then jihadists make fabulous shock troops.
Yeah.
Right? Because destruction without any
plan
is irrational for them. But what does not make sense, and I've mentioned several different European countries and other languages, I haven't lived there for quite a while, and looking at them, it seems as though some gene for self-preservation has gone missing, and not just for themselves, but what you described as the enemy driver for you, which was to look at your daughter and her future, that's another thing. It's like, well, if not self-preservation, then how about your children? And so I'm just wondering if you can help from, I've lived a lot overseas, but as an American, I've looked at what's going on in Europe right now with absolute inability to understand. Not the political class, I get the power dynamics.
But not the people.
But those people who cannot speak and they don't have First Amendment rights and they're in the criminalization of thought are not turning in droves, little trickles. But I don't see 80%, 90% moving to the few conservative options that they have, because they do exist on the European continent. And I don't see that happening. Brexit and Trump are phenomena of the Anglosphere.
Mm-hmm.
I'm talking about the Europeans now. And they are inexplicable to me. Even though I've lived in several countries, today I look at them and I'm thinking, what is going on? Because they still do have elections, for however much longer. Can you provide any insight to that?
I think the one simple answer to your question will be, after World War II or after 1989, communism was never defeated. It was never defeated on the battlefield. And I can tell you, in Austria, but all across continental Europe, the political parties, even the freedom parties, even Marine Le Pen, even the Austrian Freedom Party, are to some degree socialist, okay? And for me, it is, I'm like you, I simply cannot understand it. And you know how many times I tell my parents, look, this is the latest idea from our government. Do you get it? I tell my parents, do you get it? This is socialism, this is pure socialism, and I despise socialism. And my parents, who are in their mid-70s, they were children during the war, they were socialized under socialism. Mm-hmm. And they don't really get it. What I don't understand is, can you switch it off, please? I was asked whether I think that Angela Merkel is naive or if there's a hidden agenda or something like that. She was definitely a communist youth leader, and I will tell you, yes, she's still a communist, maybe a closet communist, but still a communist, and she has an agenda, so she's not naive. She knows exactly what's going on. Sorry, that was the first question. Yeah. Yeah, yes, ma'am.
What is the pushback in Europe? I'm just hearing on the news, Turkey and the Netherlands are doing a little battle over something. There must be sound and fury under the surface. Is it the socialist background then that people got used to the government? I just told you in the speech, there's something.
Speak out because they're afraid. They don't want to lose their job. Okay, no organization whatsoever. People know what's going on. Lots of people, not all of them, but lots of people know what's going on. But they know exactly what the repercussions are, so they won't say anything. And silence means. I don't know, survival? Look, I mean, you've paid a price, I've paid a price, I don't know.
Can you do this speech back home?
No. No, I cannot do this speech back home. Under no circumstances, I would not find an audience, and I would not find a place where I can actually speak.
We'll
no. Wait. One at a time. Yes, ma'am. Arab world, right?
By the way, do you know who Obama's favorite and most trusted foreign leader is? Yes.
Well, I'm not. Right. Of course.
Erdogan. Obama's favorite and most trusted foreign leader.
Now you understand why Resolution 1618 was so easy for Hillary to get into. Yeah. Okay, I think we should one. Noni, but I think we. Yeah.
Okay, too.
Scandinavians.
Are they leaving? The people who can afford to leave, will they leave?
No. There's lots of Germans leaving.
Where are they going?
Where are they going?
That's a good question.
We could use about 10 million votes.
The prop. I'm not really sure they're going to vote
liberal
the way you want them to vote. I'm not really sure.
The ones who will flee would still
it's not. Yeah, again, it's conditioning. Remember, Europe is a socialist continent. Okay? Why do you think I hadn't heard of Ayn Rand before I got into this? Mm-hmm. Okay? There's so many books that I missed out on, even though I was partially raised in the US. Okay? There's so many things I still don't know and I still have to learn. So anyway, you want to finish it up? You have the last word.
Tyranny was going to rise in Europe regardless whether Islam was there or not. I think Islam is being embraced because it coincidentally gives them the excuse to make it, to hasten it, to make it faster.
Okay, Noni, I totally agree with you. My own addition to what you said would be I personally don't think that Islam is to blame for everything. It's a symptom rather than the cause. We in Europe have lost our values. We have lost ourselves. We lost religion, Judeo-Christian values. And if you don't believe in anything, it's easy to believe everything. So the everything in this case is Islam. So that's what I always say. I don't blame Islam for everything. We always we also have to do our own homework. Okay? So again, you know, thank you so much for coming tonight. Thank you, Karen. The podium is yours.
European dissidents who will report on what's going on in Europe. So if you're interested in that, I can use your support, because I will also use anything that, you know, I get from this to help other dissidents so we can become stronger, because the other side has a lot of money. Mm-hmm. And $2.50 is not even a Starbucks coffee, and that's per month. Right. So if you can support
this. What's the website?
This, it's called encountertruth.com, and it's not started yet. It hasn't gone live, but I also have some paper where you can sign up, and you will be informed via email when we go live, and I would love to see you. It's going to be interactive, so you can also ask questions when I go live, and I can have up to 3 guests at the same time, and you know, who knows what's going to happen. I'll have some great people on, and we'll have some great discussion. So I have those cards. I'll hand them out, and now I'll hand it over to Karen.